Good afternoon, everyone. First of all, we hope you are all doing well and thank you for joining us today. Today's webinar will be one of the last and will focus on the IPA for SME service implementation for beneficiaries of the cutoffs 9, 10, and 11. My name is Rassamy Couturier and I am a project manager at Gopacom, a communications agency based in Brussels that is partnering the IPA for SME consortium. I will support Margot Cazadio, who will give you the presentation today. Margot is an expert from CARSA, the IPA for SME consortium leader. During the webinar, we invite you to write down any question that you may have in the question box. Marco will make sure to answer to you at the end of the presentation. And for any specific questions, the IPA for SME Coordination Center will follow them individually and address them by email. It's time for me to leave the floor to Marco, so enjoy the webinar.
Good afternoon to everybody, and thank you very much. Thank you very much. As you learned, my name is Marco Zadio, innovation consultant working for CARSA, who is the leader of the IPA for SME project. And today we organized it together with GOPA this informative webinar with the aim of explaining you how to proceed in order to benefit the most from the support services we offered within this program in an easy and efficient way. As you can see in the screen, today I'm going to discuss together with you how it works the guide for beneficiary. Specifically, we are going to discover all the aspects, the requirements to be met, and we will use for this the guide for beneficiary design for the beneficiary selected within cutoff call 11. Later on, once we will finish the discussion as regard to the guide, I prepared for you a presentation where basically I included all the most frequently asked questions received in the course of this program in order to summarize again the most important information. And then, as I assembly explained to you, in case you have some doubts or uncertainty, please feel free to write in the question box also the question that you have. At the end of this webinar, we'll try to answer to all of them directly during the webinar. So, before starting with the discussion of the guide, please let me just introduce to you two important information. The first one is that the idea behind this program is that the European Commission strongly believes that the protection of intellectual property is crucial for you in order to promoting innovation and for improving your competitiveness, at least at European level. For this reason, the main goal of this program is to facilitate and promote the use of intellectual property. And to do it, we basically offer you financial and expert support in order to valorize and protect the intellectual property. Can benefit from these services all small medium enterprises who have received a seal of excellence from the Horizon 2020 Small Medium Enterprise Sustainable Program, together with small medium enterprises recognized as innovative company. Another important information I would like to provide you is that it's really important to understand that for all the beneficiaries who have been awarded to receive more than one service, please keep in mind, this is really important, that as a beneficiary, you are not forced to follow any particular order in completing the service. This basically means that, for example, if you have been selected with both service 1, 2, and 3, you are not forced to complete service 1 before benefiting of service 2 and service 3. As small medium enterprise, you can make use of all the services in parallel on one after the other, but free to you. However, in case you have been selected with service 1 and at least one of the two co-financing services, my strong recommendation is to try to complete the IP diagnostic service as soon as possible, because one of the scope of this service is that the expert at the end is going to provide you useful information that can help you to decide if it's better or not to proceed with a filling of a patent or not. But again, feel free to start benefiting from the services as you wish. For example, if you are a company selecting which service 2 or service 3, please keep in mind that you can start benefiting from service 3 even if you did not receive any payment reimbursement with service 2. So let's move with this guideline. Again, it's the guideline that we developed within cutoff call 11. The majority of the information we are going to discuss are similar to the other calls. Just the only different things is the timeline. And I'm going to explain you later on how it works. So the use of EMS. Please keep in mind that all the support services will be managed through the IPA for SME electronic submission system, also simply recognized as EMS platform. So in case you have been selected as beneficiary, please keep in mind that especially if you are being selected with service 2 or service 3, that all the documentation, which are usually an invoice together with the proof of payment, must be uploaded within this portal to be officially revised. So in case you are a beneficiary, please keep in mind that there is a specific link that you have to click on in order to logging into EMS. Once you are here, by visiting the My Project section under the My Area menu, you will be directed in a new space where all the information regarding your company, the cutoff call date, and also the support action granted will be displayed. Once you are here, clicking on Go to Support Documentation under the Action column, you will be redirected to a new screen. Will show you that there are two possible sections. The first one, which is for me the most important, is support documentation, and then there is a second one called reimbursement. As regards to the support documentation, please keep in mind that this is a place specifically decided for you to upload all the required documentation that support the subsequent reimbursement. So in this is the place where as a beneficiary of service 2 or service 3, you are requested to provide us the documentation. We usually have, again, an invoice together with the corresponding proof of payment. Once you request a first payment reimbursement, in case this reimbursement will be validated, what you have to do basically is to provide us all the information regarding your financial bank account, which are information that we need to collect in order to reimburse you. In this case, this document must be uploaded in the reimbursement space. But again, please keep in mind that this is a step always coming later on, only once the service 2 and 3 will be correctly activated. How this service must be activated, we are going to discuss soon. So please keep in mind again, sorry to be repeated, that as a beneficiary, you have to be, you have to familiarize as soon as possible with this IPA for SME electronic submission system, because again, all the services will be managed only through this platform. Then, other important information for you is that during the entire process, as a beneficiary, we will kindly ask you to complete a series of surveys as a part of your award. As you can see in table 1, the type of survey and the time frame strongly depends on the services awarded, because, for example, if you are a beneficiary of service 1, there is this service 1 satisfaction survey, that is a survey that you have to complete, which is not mandatory for the service 2 or service 3. And also, as you can see, there is this kind of survey has to be completed before and after the completion of the your support services. The most important one, in my point of view, is the HEPA for SME self-assessment, which is the first survey you have to complete. And this is extremely important that you have to complete it because it's, because any of the services awarded can be started if you do not filling it this survey. So please keep in mind that, again, any of the services awarded can cannot begin if you are not if you did not complete this survey. So if you did not do yet, please do it as soon as possible. The link to complete the HEPA for SME self-assessment is in the email you received from the HEPA for SME coordination center. Specifically is the email as regard to the communication of the services awarded. However, in case you are not able to find this link again, please contact us. Later on, I will give you the email you can use to contact us, so we can proceed to share with you the link to complete the HEPA for SME self-assessment. Other important information or regards of the survey and the reason why you have to complete it are provided in the guide. When you have time, feel free to take a look on it if you are interested. We are now going to move to the description of the service, the time frame, and the requirements that you have to meet in order to receive support. As I said you before, within HEPA for SME, we basically offer you three different services. One is called the IP Diagnostic Service, which is focused on providing you advices to boost your capabilities in terms of intellectual property, together with two co-financing services. One focused on providing you partial reimbursement of the cost of the official cost to filling a European pattern, and the third one is a co-financing service where the aim is to partially reimburse the cost for hire a pattern attorney with the purpose of filling a European pattern process. So we're going to discuss service one by one. Let's start with service one. So service one again is also recognized as IP diagnostic, sometimes also as IP scanning. And as you can understand easily by the name, this service is a service offered to you focused on providing comprehensive IP diagnostic service to boost your capabilities and competencies in the field of intellectual property. We consider this service as a great opportunity to you to count on a qualified expert in the field of intellectual property and business strategy with the aim of identifying both advantage and potential opportunities of filling a patent. Please keep in mind that the service is not focused on your invention, but more on the business strategy that your company developed or is going to develop in order to benefit the most from your invention. So again, this service is more focused on the business strategy you can use to benefit the most from your invention rather than to discuss directly on your invention. So through this service as a beneficiary, the opportunity to identify the main limitation and areas of development to strengthen your competencies in the field of intellectual property and foster your business competitiveness. So how it works, service one? As you can see, service one, the workflow service one consists of five main steps. The first one, as I explained you before, is the completion of the HEPA for SME self-assessment, without which the service cannot begin. Once you complete this document, this survey, the coordination center will facilitate the initial contact between you and the expert. This process will differ slightly depending on the beneficiary country, because as you can see, For all those small medium enterprises located in countries such as Austria, Denmark, France, Netherlands, Spain, the expert will be assigned to you directly by your national IP office. In this case, once collected your IPA frozen self-assessment, what we do as a coordination center is to contact your national IP office, providing them the list of the company that have completed the IPA frozen self-assessment, and then they are in charge of providing you the name and the main contact of the expert assigned to you for the completion and implementation of the IP diagnostic service. Instead, for all those small medium enterprises located in Greece, Latvia, Ireland, Italy, Sweden, we are the main actors in charge of providing you the contact of the expert, and in some cases it also could happen that instead of providing you directly the contact of a person, we provide you a list of experts that you can select from. As regard to this last aspect, please keep in mind that within cutoff call 11 and 10, since these calls were not planned at the beginning of the program, we decided to assign to the company selected within service one directly an expert rather than providing them a list. This is just to make the process faster and to skip all the bureaucracy problem that we can have. Because again, as I said you before, cutoff call 10 and 11, they were not expected at the beginning of the program. So the time frame to complete this service are shorter compared to the previous cutoff call. So in order to make the process faster, we decided to assign to you directly an expert instead of providing you a list of them. So once the expert has been assigned to you by us or by your national IP office, the two parties, which are you and the expert, can start to communicate and agree on a schedule for the implementation of the service. We are now so in the phase three, which is the media content scheduling. Then, once you schedule a possible day for the implementation of the service, the IP diagnostic service can start. As regards to the IP diagnostic service, please keep in mind that the service itself consists of five three main steps. There is a first initial analysis of your environment. In order to do this, the expert is going to conduct some desk research as regard to your company, competitors, market, and so on. In order to do this, could be also useful for him or her to collect information from the IPA frozen self-assessment. This is one of the reasons why it is mandatory to complete it as soon as possible, because some of the information are coming directly from this survey. Then there is the visit and interview, where basically the expert is going to interview you by conducting an in-depth interview, which should last between 2 and 4 hours. As regards to the interview, please keep in mind that the interview can be conducted in person or via video teleconferences. You can decide which is the most comfortable for you. My strong recommendation, when it's possible, is to conduct the interview in person, but since the outbreak of the virus, the manager of the company and also the expert, they were more comfortable to conduct the interview via video teleconferences. In the last 1 year and a half, at least 95% of the company decided to move through the video teleconferences. And what we learned is that at the end, almost all of the company, they were really, really satisfied to proceed with a video teleconferences rather than to conduct the interview in person. So As regards to this aspect, feel free to select the interview way that you prefer, but again, please keep in mind that the results at the end, they are quite similar. Once that the interview is ended, in 2-3 weeks, the expert is expected to deliver to you the results of the complete analysis in a report, which is confidential, which means that you are the only one that can access to you. And once the expert delivers to you this report, is also in charge of explaining you a possible suggestion, advice that can be good for you to understand if what you can do to improve your business strategy in terms of intellectual property. Also, as regard to this suggestion, the expert and the company can decide if the call should be conducted in person or via video teleconferences. As regard to the reports, please keep in mind that usually the report contains information as regard a clear diagnostic of your business strategy in terms of intellectual property, together with a clear overview of all the opportunities and main limitations to foster and boost IP advantage and exploit benefits. Please keep in mind that service one is totally free of charge, which means that all the costs will be supported by the coordination center. This is one of the reasons why the expert for the implementation can be only the person assigned by us or by the National IP Office, because basically we reached agreement with them as regard to the cost. So please keep in mind that you cannot implement the service with an expert that you propose. Again, the only expert that can conduct the IP diagnostic service are person assigned by us or by the National IP Office. And other important information is that the IP diagnostic service should be completed before the 31 December 2021. Why? Because this is also the official day where the IPA for SME program will be officially ended. And that another important information is that as regard to the meeting, please consider that the expert, we have an agreement where basically the expert is forced, let's say forced, to conduct only one interview with you, which again can take between 2 and 4 hours. So before scheduling a possible meeting, please take into consideration this timeline, because if you will not have the opportunity to provide all the information requested by the expert is not forced to conduct together with you another interview, which means that the report that you are going to collect will be a partial report without containing all the important information that you need to receive. Other important information as regard to this service, again, are included in the guide. I think that explain you all the most important one, but again, my strong recommendation also always to take a look in detail as of the guide, because maybe some information were skipped. Let's go to service two. Service two is one of the two co-financing services that we offer to you within this program. And specifically, service two is focused on providing you economic support to cover a percentage of small medium enterprise patent application fee before the European Patent Office. Please consider that service two and service three, our support exclusively cover European patent registration process, which for the purpose of IPA for SME is defined as filing an application for a patent before the EPO, covering more than 2 European member states. We can consider eligible within service 2 and service 3 also PCT patent application, also recognized as international, but only if the filing process done through the EPO office. Therefore, please keep in mind that cost for IP protection in country like USA, China, Brazil, and so on, they cannot be covered within this program because, again, we only support, our support exclusively covers European patent registration process. Through Service 2, you can receive the 75% of EPO fee cost up to a maximum of €2,500 per single patent application. So, as you can see, also in this case, Service 2 workflow consists of 5 main steps. First step that is the IPA for SME self-assessment, the competition of IPA for SME self-assessment, because again, just a reminder, you have to complete, otherwise the service cannot begin. Then there is step 2 and 3, which I consider, personally consider that the most important service, because these two steps are the steps that are essential for you for the activation of the service. Why I'm talking about activation of the service? Because it's really important to you to understand that being awarded with service 2 and service 3 does not mean that the service is activated. To activate a service, a co-financing service, as a beneficiary, you must provide to us within the end of the project valid documentation by uploading them on the EMS portal. Valid documentation for us consists of an invoice together with the corresponding proof of payment, which must meet specific requirements that will be discussed soon. So again, please keep in mind that being awarded with service 2, service 3 does not mean that service is activated. And to activate the service, you must provide us within EMS portal at least an invoice together with the corresponding proof of payment. As regard to the time frame, please keep in mind that, as explained before, since the cutoff 10 and cutoff 11 they were not expected at the beginning of the program, some rules changed, because before we were asked the company to complete to activate the services awarded within 4 months. This requirement changed for logistics. So now please keep in mind that for beneficiary of cutoff call 11, you have 16 weeks to complete the services, because again, the program will be officially ended the 31 December 2021. So, what we need from you to activate the service and to reimburse you. Again, from you, we need an invoice together with the corresponding proof of payment. As regard to the invoice, there can be two specific situations. Situation A is when the IPO patent registration is made by an IP patent attorney on behalf of the beneficiary company, but there is also a second situation, which is situation B, that is when the IPO registration is made directly by you, by your company. So let's discuss first on regards or situation A, which is again is when the IPO patent registration is made by an IP patent attorney on behalf of you. So if it is your case, please keep in mind that to activate the receive reimbursement, you must receive from us, we must receive from you, sorry, an invoice together with the proof of payment. As regard to the invoice, please keep in mind that the beneficiary can only be reimbursed once they have one or more valid invoice from an IP patent attorney, and to be considered this invoice valid, the invoice must be dated after the date of the communication of IPA for SME support, which is for cutoff call 11, the 10th September 2021. And then to qualify the reimbursement, the invoice must include information as regards the name of the patent attorney added by you, the patent application process, which is simply the reference title of your invention or the IP being protected, but also the invoice must contain information as regards the IPO debit order number, also recognized as IPO service codes. Why this? Because within IPA for SME program, not all the IPO service codes are eligible to be reimbursed, but we can refund only the cost of the IPO service codes included in the table 2. Why I don't have a specific answer for this? Because these are the rules communicated by the European Commission, and we are, as a leader of the project, we are just following what the European Commission requests to us. But again, please keep in mind that not all the IPO service codes can be refunded within IPA for SME program, but only those included in table 2. This is the reason why the only way to validate your invoice is that the invoice must contain detailed information as regard to the IPO service codes covered during the filing process. As regard to this detailed information, please keep in mind that you can include the invoice or just the codes, IPO codes, for example, 001, 005, and so on, or you can include the description of the code, like, for example, filing fee, designation fee, or you can include both information. One of the three options is fine for us, but again, we must be sure that the invoice clearly states which IPO service code were covered during the filing process. Together with this invoice, we must also collect from you the corresponding proof of payment. As regard to this document, please keep in mind that as a beneficiary, you have to provide us proof that the IP patent attorney invoice has been paid before partial reimbursement can occur. We can accept only bank transfer receipts, which clearly indicate the name of your company, the IP patent attorney, and the invoice. Also in this case, the proof of payment is valid if the date of the payment is after the date of the communication of IPA for SME support, which is, I remind you again, for all the beneficiaries selected within cutoff call 11 was the last 10th September 2021. This is everything as regard to option situation A. Let's now move to situation B, because as I told you before, there is also the situation, even if is the less used, which is when the IPO patent registration is made directly by you as a company. In this case, rather than collecting an invoice from the patent attorney, what we need from you is to collect a valid IPO debit order submission with confirmation, which is basically a document released by the IP office when you're filing a patent. So in this case, please keep in mind that as a beneficiary, we can reimburse you only if you have this document, which is usually a PDF document, that again is released by the IPO office when the patent is filing correctly. As regard to this document, please keep in mind, this is really important, that you must be aware to save or print the confirmation immediately after submitting the online debit order in the IPO online filing system, as you will not be able to do this later on, which means that if you lose this opportunity, you will never be able to collect a valid documentation to be reimbursed. If you move through situation B, in order to be reimbursed, the valid EPO debit or the submission confirmation must contain all information as regards the title of the invention and the EPO debit order number covered during the filling process. This information are usually collected in section 13 of the EPO debit order submission confirmation. Together with this document, also in this case, we must collect from you the corresponding proof of payment. In this case, as we see before, we saw before, only bank aspect receipts can be accepted. So once we have the invoice and the corresponding proof of payment, or the EPO valid debit order submission confirmation together with the corresponding proof of payment, only once you have both documents, you can request a partial reimbursement. And to do it, you have to upload this documentation within EMS portal, and you have to do it by uploading all the documents in a single PDF or zip file. This is up to you, but please keep in mind that invoice and proof of payment must be may be uploaded in a single PDF or zip file, but I personally recommend you to upload all of them in one single PDF or zip file. Also, please keep in mind that it is not mandatory to provide us an invoice in English. You are free to provide us an invoice in your national language, but in order to facilitate the revision process, what we can request you is to at least include the following model statement in the invoice, in order that it will be easier for us to check all the embossed information we need to collect to understand if the documentation you provide us is valid or not to be reimbursed. So again, you are not forced to provide us invoice in English. You can provide us invoice in your national language, Spanish, Italian, Hungary, whatever it is, but at least try to request to your patent attorney to include the following model statement. Other important information as regards to service 2 is that once the service 2 reimbursement are limited to 2 requests, which basically means that once you request a first partial reimbursement, in case all the documentation meet the requirements, what we basically usually do is to communicate by email that we have validated your documentation, giving also information as regards to the reimbursement expected. Once you activate the service, we're also giving you, together with a first payment reimbursement, also the opportunity to provide us documentation for claim a second payment request. However, it is important to understand that this documentation must be always associated to the same patent invention through which you activate the service and you receive the first payment reimbursement. Then there is this last step, which is the confirmation of reimbursement, in which basically once you have received the reimbursement, the coordination center is kindly ask you to provide us to upload into MS a senior confirmation using the model provided in the support documentation, where basically declare that you have received the reimbursement correctly. As regards to service 2, I think I told you everything. We will move now to service 2, in case you have some doubts or in case I think that I skip some important information. Surely we are going to discuss again during the presentation I prepared for you. Service 3. Service 3 is another co-financing service, one of the two offered within IPA for SME program. And the scope of this service, as you can immediately understand, just reading the name of the service, is that within this service, we cover the cost for hiring an active patent attorney for the purpose of preparing the filing of a European patent. But watch out, because within service 3, we can consider eligible also the cost for hiring an IP patent attorney, even if for a specific reason that we are not, is not necessary to provide us, even if you decide to discontinue your initial idea of patent application. So please really watch out as regards to this, because a lot of time, small medium enterprises lost the opportunity to be reimbursed because they did not understand this important aspect. Again, within service 3, we consider both costs for hiring the patent attorney in case you decide to go towards the filing of a European patent process, but we can cover the cost even if you decide to discontinue an initial idea of patent application. The final support will aim at covering the 50% of the cost incurred up to a maximum of €2,000 per single patent application. Also in this case, we cover all European patent registration process, the cost for European patent registration process, or PCT patent, but only if the registration process is done through the EPO office. Also in this case, similar to what we see before, the workflow consists of 5 main steps and the time frame is basically the same, as we can see. You have 16 weeks to provide us documentation for requesting reimbursement. So you will have until the 31 December 2021 to provide us documentation to request a reimbursement. Again, the 31 December 2021 is the official last day of the program. And then, also in this case, as you can see, the workflow consists of 5 main steps. First of all, the completion of IPA for SME self-assessment. Then there is the step which we usually call activation of the process, which consists of provide us an invoice together with the corresponding proof of payment. Once you have these two documents, you can request a partial reimbursement. And when the service is activated, together with receiving a first payment reimbursement, we will also give you the opportunity to provide us documentation for claim a second payment. Once you receive the reimbursement, the last step is the confirmation of the reimbursement receiver. We are going now to see step by step how the workflow works in order to provide you especially all the information as regard to the requirements of the documentation you must meet in order to receive the reimbursement. So as regard to the activation of the process, also in this case we must collect from you an invoice together with the corresponding proof of payment. As regard to the invoice, please keep in mind that as a beneficiary, you can only be reimbursed once you have one or more valid invoice from an IP patent attorney entitled to act before the EPO. I'm going to give you more information as regard to this aspect in a few seconds. Then, to be considered service 2, service 3 reimbursement, the invoice must be issued again to a patent attorney who appears in the on the EPO list of professional representatives, and the invoice must be issued after the date of the communication of IPA for SME support. I notify here an error because it's not the 28th of July, but it's the 10th of September. Sorry for these inconveniences. I just notify now, but please keep in mind that the invoice must be issued after the date of the communication of award, which for beneficiary of cutoff call 11 is the 10th September 2021, while the 28th July is for the beneficiary selected within cutoff call 10. Then, to qualify the reimbursement, The invoice must include information as regards the name of the patent attorney, the patent application process, and the, when possible, only when possible, the IPO patent application number, or a statement regarding your decision to discontinue the patent application process. In case you decide to discontinue the patent application process, please keep in mind that a model statement is provided by you in Annex 2 of this guideline. So going in Annex 1, you will find directly the model statement you must complete, and this model statement must be provided together with the invoice and the corresponding proof of payment. Then, as regard to this requirement, which is the IP patent attorney that must be entitled to act before the IPO, please keep in mind that at the end in the guide, there is directly the link where you have to click on in order to check if the attorney following you is entitled or not to act before the IPO. So please check it before going through towards the filing process, because if we notify that the attorney is not entitled to act before the IPO, we cannot reimburse your cost. And then also in this case, please keep in mind that it's not mandatory to provide us invoice in English. You can provide us invoice your national language, but also in this case, if you can, please request your attorney to at least include the short model statement in English in order to facilitate the revision process. Together with the invoice, also in this case, you must provide us also the proof of payment. Only in this case, we can accept only bank transfer receipts, which could indicate the name of the beneficiary, the patent attorney, and the invoice number. Once you have both documents, what you have to do is to upload this in a single PDF or zip file into the EMS portal. And only in the case the documentation is valid, only in this case you are going to receive a reimbursement. And once you receive the reimbursement, the last step to complete the service is to upload into EMS the confirmation of the reimbursement. Also in this case, please keep in mind that a model is provided by you automatically every time you upload an invoice and the corresponding proof of payment. Also in this case, please keep in mind that service to reimbursement is limited to two requests. So please keep in mind that you should be aware that once you have made a second request for reimbursement, you will not be able to make additional requests, even if you have not reached the maximum reimbursement amount, which again is 2,000 euro per service 3, 2,500 euro per service 2. Before moving to the presentation, final important rules for you, which is that is really important to understand that the key basic IPA for semi-univocal correspondence is that one patent application process could be associated to only one single patent, which basically means that documents provided by you to claim partial reimbursement must only refer to and contain information about one single patent. Documentation containing information about several patents will not be allowed. So again, please keep in mind that if you apply only one time, you can request the reimbursement of only one patent. Number application can be one application can be associated to only one patent. So, for example, if I have Carsa Company and I applied 5 different times, this means that I can request reimbursement of 5 different patents. Otherwise, no. Other important information I would like to give you is that, again, we are not revising the document day by day. We usually revise document every 2 weeks when it is possible. Once we validate the documentation, we usually send an email to you informing you if we validated or not the reimbursement. If yes, we provide you also the information as regards to the reimbursement expected. If not, we provide you information or regards the reason why we cannot validate the reimbursement. And when possible, we also give you a possible advice in order to receive the reimbursement later on. Other important information is that officially we have, once we validate the document, we have theoretically 2 months to reimburse you. However, we are trying only to do our best in order to reimburse you as soon as possible. But again, please keep in mind that according to the agreement signed with the European Commission, we have theoretically 2 months to reimburse you, and the 2 months start once we validate your documentation. At the end of the guide, you will find, as I said you before, model statement in case you decide to discontinue the patent application process, an X1, and also a second model in case you decide to cancel one of the support services received. Please keep in mind that if you decide to cancel your support service, this does not mean that you cannot benefiting from the other service awarded. So, for example, if you decide to cancel support service 1, but I have been awarded with service 2 and service 3-2, I can continue to benefit from service 2 or service 3 and not of service 1. As regards to the guide, I think I explained you everything, at least the most important things. Let's move now to the presentation in order to summarize together with you the most important frequently asked question. Just give me a few seconds to change the screen. So I think everybody can see the presentation and now in the correct way. So as I said to you before, I prepared this presentation collecting the most frequently asked question received in the during the first 2.5 years of the program. And the scope is just to summarize again what we have already discussed. So first question, is there is any time limitation for justifying EPO and IP patent attorney cost? Yes, as we learned, there is a time limitation for all the beneficiary awarded within cutoff call 11. You will have around 16 weeks to provide us documentation for activating service 2 and service 3. So you will have until the 31 December 2021 to provide us documentation for requesting a partial reimbursement. Question number 2. I'm really working with an IP patent attorney. Are his or costs reimbursable? We are talking now service 3 because as we learn, as regard to service 3, one of the requirements to receive the reimbursement is that the IP patent attorney must be a professional entitled to act before the EPO. So in this case, please keep in mind that to receive reimbursement within service 3, the person issuing the invoice must be a professional entitled to act before the EPO who has been hired by you for the purpose of preparing the filing of a European patent or at least a PCT patent being done through the EPO. A list of eligible IP patent attorney can be found in the following link at page 1820 of our guide for beneficiary. Please keep in mind that all of the beneficiary should be already possessed this guide because we sent to you the 3rd week of September, if I remember well. But you can also access to this guide directly through the EMS portal. Question number 3. Are all type of patents eligible to be subject of FIPA for SME support? The answer is not, because as we learned, our support exclusively covers European patent registration process, which for the purpose of HIPAA for SME program is defined as filling an application for a patent before the EPO covering more than two European member states. Therefore, cost for IP protection in countries like USA, China, Brazil, and other countries that are not European member states, they cannot be reimbursed. Question number four. What if a service tree beneficiary does not have an EPO patent application number yet? As we learned you before, for qualified service tree, we must collect from you an invoice containing information as regard to the name of the patent attorney, the patent application process, also the EPO patent application number. However, could be the case that even if you already started the filling process, you did not collect yet this number. Why? Because usually this number is provided to you by the EPO office only once the filling process is completed. However, as I said you before, could be the case that even if you did not complete the filling process yet, the attorney already provided you an invoice. So in this case, if this is the case, don't be worried, because if you do not possess yet the EPO patent application number, we can reimburse the invoice without any restriction, hesitation. So if this is your case, please keep in mind that in this case, the invoice must contain all information of the name of the patent attorney and the patent application process. This information will be enough for us. Question number five, is there is any specific order for service implementation? In other words, if I order with service one, two, and three, do small, medium enterprise have to wait until the end of the IP diagnostic is finished to start benefiting from partial reimbursement? The answer is not, because as I said you at the beginning of this webinar, as beneficiary, you are free to decide if you complete services, if you start benefiting of the services in parallel or one after the other one. And also that there is not a mandatory order to follow in order to receive reimbursement or to benefiting from the service. So for example, if you are a company awarded with service one, two, and three, you can start to benefiting from service two before to benefit of service one, service three, same of service three, and so on. So again, feel free to benefit from the service as you prefer. Question number six, what is service activation? Service 2 and Service 3 can only be considered activate when beneficiary have uploaded valid documentation into EMS. As I repeated you several times, I'm going to do again. It is extremely important to understand that being awarded with Service 2 and 3 does not mean that Service 2 and 3 are activated. Activation can be executed only once you provide us an invoice together with the corresponding proof of payment. Both documentation must meet all the requirements, including the guide, which are also the requirements that we discussed previously. Question number seven, is VAT subject of reimbursement? No, VAT costs are not taken into account during the reimbursement calculation process. Then, in case you have some doubts, uncertainties, or whatever, or in case, for example, you would like to check if the invoice is valid before to upload it in the MS, please keep in mind that the HIPAA for SME Coordination Center has put at your disposal two possible email accounts. You can contact us at @hipaaforsme.eu. Or you can also contact us at helpdesk outside HIPAAforSME.eu. We usually do our best to provide you an answer within 48 hours. However, it is correct to say that many times it can happen that we are not able to provide you an answer within 48 hours. This is usually for two specific cases. One is that several times we received dozens and dozens of emails that we are not able to answer to all of them in 48 hours, but it could also be the case that sometimes we are not your email is going directly to the spam box, which honestly is a box that we never check. So my recommendation is that in case you see that after 3-4 days you did not receive any answer from us, my recommendation is to send again the email, because again, as I said you before, could happen that is the spam box receiving your email, which is a box that we never check. You can follow us on LinkedIn, Facebook, LinkedIn. Again, the consortium consists of Casas, the leader of the project, Università di Alicante, and Gopa.com. We are now going to move to the question box, hoping that I am able to answer to all your doubts. Okay. Just give me a second. Okay, I have 4 questions from you. Okay. The first question is from Beatrice Kemutai. I'm so sorry if I'm wronging your surname. It could happen to a lot of time also to me. So please, my sincere apologize. So Mr. Beatrice is asking me, we are based in Sweden. Our company had initially been assigned an expert who met and interviewed one of us. Unfortunately, the expert never got back to us with the result of complete analysis. What do we do in this situation? We try reaching out, but she doesn't respond to emails and doesn't pick her calls. Since she's a woman, I'm pretty sure we are talking about Sonia, I think, I don't remember now correctly the name. However, Mr. Beatrice, if this is your case, please send us an email as regard the problem you are receiving to our help desk, the email I provided you before, in order that once you receive this email, this complaint, we can contact the Sweden International AP office, highlighting them as regards the issue you are facing, hoping that the National IP Office will solve the problem as soon as possible. Our sincere apologies if you are facing this problem. Again, as a coordination center, what we can do is to contact the National IP Office, asking them to provide the report as soon as possible, since this is part of the agreement signed with them. So please don't forget to contact us by mail. So again, we can contact directly the National IP Office, including you in copy and requesting what it is missing. Then there is a question, which is not a question, from Sofia Vieira, which is a person I received from her different email in the last days. I'm sorry that you have problem to listen, but it seems that you were the only one to have this problem. I don't know why, because it seems that everybody were able to listen without problem. I'm sorry for the problem you face. Okay, it is okay already. Okay, Mr. Vieira, welcome. I'm happy to see that at the end you were able to listen everything. So okay, then there is The last question from Mr. Elko Van Dam. Nice surname. If we plan to file an initial patent to a national patent office and target or fill a PCT to European office, will the initial filing also will be for reimbursement? The answer, Mr. Elko, is not. Why not? Because again, we cannot consider national. We cannot consider the cost for a national patent registration valid. We can consider all the next cost eligible, which means that if you fill a PCT patent to the European office, we can consider this cost eligible, both cost PCT official fee and also the cost for hiring the patent attorney. But again, unfortunately, national patent cannot be reimbursed. Why? Because these are the rules the European Commission decided. I personally know that some of the requirements are quite restricted, which means that it's not that easy to receive reimbursement, especially as regard to the EPO fee cost or the PCT fee cost. But again, as a coordination center, we must respect what the European Commission requested to us and us and everything this is. However, what I can tell to all of you is that once we have an idea or an advice to help you, to support you receiving the reimbursement, we always try to give you this information. So, in case you have some doubts, even if the doubt could be, let's say, stupid, don't be worried, ask us, because our work here is to help you in all the possible way, in order that at the end of the year you will receive the reimbursement. So if you have doubts on the time, don't be worried, contact us as soon as possible, and we will do our best to help in supporting you. This was the last question from Mr. Van Dam. I hope everything was clear. Again, thank you very much for following us. In case you have some doubts, contact us, and we are trying to do our best to support you. I wish you a great Thursday afternoon and also a weekend since we are close. Thank you very much and have a nice day. And thank you very much to you, Rasami, for the presentation. Bye.
Welcome. Bye. Have a nice day all.